BioVivacious, I'm Sebastian. BioVivacious is a YouTube channel dedicated to clear fundamentals of biosciences and make the subject exciting. In a previous video on glycogen structure, we have looked at the detailed structure of glycogen and how it forms a left-handed helix, left-handed alpha helix with 6.5 residues per turn. So this structure we had seen, and we have also looked at the kind of branching that occurs in the structure of glycogen. So therefore, now what we are going to do is we are going to look at the metabolism of glycogen. Remember, the metabolism of glycogen is regularly happening in liver as well as in muscle. In liver, the metabolism of glycogen, it is synthesis as well as degradation. So this word glycogenolysis, it stands for genolysis, it is for breakdown of glycogen. So the synthesis of glycogen is glycogenesis. This will be synthesis of glycogen. Once we complete glycogenolysis, we will look at the synthesis of glycogen. So in liver, glycogenolysis and glycogenesis will be equal, whereas in the case of muscle, the glycogenolysis will be much faster, because muscle is responsible for yielding energy, produce ATP molecules. So therefore, it will exceed, glycogenolysis exceed roughly about 300 fold than glycogenesis. Now also remember the structure. We go back to that video to see the structure of glycogen. Especially I mentioned about the alpha rosette. Okay. And also the non-reducing end. So we have seen that there are roughly about 2000 non-reducing end. To get clarity on this, let us write down once more the only about two residues we'll write down here. Residue number one and residue number two. So linked by 1,4 alpha glycosidic bond, and it can have an alpha 1,6 glycosidic bond here. So it will keep on, another glucose residues will be added. So this is the non-reducing end, okay? Assume this is the last residue. It goes on like this, okay? This is the last residue, non-reducing end. Now, the glycogenolysis, that is with the help of an enzyme known as glycogen phosphorylase. We will look at this enzyme elaborately later on. So, glycogen phosphorylase. Now, glycogen phosphorylase, what it does is it will add an inorganic phosphate. Okay, an inorganic phosphate is added. Now, this inorganic phosphate will cleave here, and that inorganic phosphate gets attached here. Okay, so inorganic phosphate is getting attached. So, this becomes glucose 1-phosphate. It becomes glucose 1-phosphate, and this becomes an OH. The non-reducing, this is the fourth carbon, this is OH, and this becomes with an inorganic phosphate, and it becomes a glucose 1-phosphate. What is important for us to know is a glycosidic bond is replaced by a phosphoryl ester. So a glycosidic bond is replaced by a phosphoryl ester. So now let us look at what is this kind of a reaction called. Now this is very different from the kind of reactions that you would have seen earlier in other pathways. So this kind of a cleaving of a sugar by using an orthophosphate is known as phosphorylysis. Now this is against the concept of hydrolysis. So hydrolysis is we use a molecule of water and then we break it. Okay, so you would have seen hydrolysis reaction happening in gluconeogenesis. There were two reactions where hydrolysis were happening. You can recollect it For example, conversion of fructose 1,6 bisphosphate to fructose 6 phosphate, that is an example of hydrolysis. Or glucose 6 phosphate to glucose is an example of hydrolysis. Whereas this is by using an orthophosphate we are hydrolyzing, that is phosphorolysis. You know, phosphorolysis has got some advantages. The biggest advantage is the end product which we are producing is glucose 1 phosphate. It is not a glucose. Okay, if it were hydrolysis, it would have been glucose. So if it were glucose that is formed in a cell, then we need to spend an ATP to make it glucose 6 phosphate. Okay, otherwise what will happen to glucose? Glucose will come out of the cell. It will move out of the cell. Whereas in the case of phosphorolysis, if the end product is already phosphorylated. So you know that phosphorylated intermediate cannot get out because it is ionized intermediates are not allowed to pass through the plasma membrane. So therefore, if the cell doesn't have to invest energy in retaining the molecule. So this is an important aspect of glycogen metabolism. Now let us also look at the energetic aspect of this. First of all, let us write the overall reaction. So the overall reaction can be, now we have a glycogen molecule. So inorganic phosphate acted, glycogen phosphorylase is the enzyme. You have produced glucose 1 phosphate and glycogen N minus 1 residue. So this is the overall equation. Now, in reality, if the overall delta G of this reaction is plus 31.1 kilojoule per mole. So with this value, you know that this is not a favorable reaction. It is not in favor of glycogen breakdown. It is in favor of glycogen synthesis. It is not in favor of glycogen breakdown, but in favor of glycogen synthesis. But you look at the cellular conditions. Cellular conditions are very different. That's why cellular conditions will control either how, in which direction a metabolism must take place. You look at the concentration of inorganic phosphate to the concentration of glucose 1 phosphate. So this is roughly about 100. Okay, so this is the intracellular concentration. Because of this high intracellular concentration, the delta G becomes minus 6 kilojoules per mole. Because of this change in the high concentration of inorganic phosphate, it becomes minus 6 kilojoules per mole and it favors the reaction. It favors glycogen degradation. Let us also look at one important aspect. Okay, so the important aspect is hydrolysis of one alpha 1,4 linkage. That will give, that is about minus 15.5 kilojoule per mole. Hydrolysis of one alpha 1,4 linkage. Hydrolysis of one alpha 6 linkage, that is minus 7.1 kilojoule per mole. So these values are important when we are trying to compare glycogen breakdown and glycogen synthesis. Now, remember we have seen that we have spent about minus 6 kilojoules per mole in phosphorolysis, and what is the net amount of energy present in glucose 1 phosphate? That is about minus 21 kilojoule per mole. Okay, so therefore there is, in fact, we have produced an end product which has got high amount of energy just because it is phosphorylated. Now, I want you to go back to if it were phosphorylated, but glucose were to be phosphorylated using ATP molecules. Remember what was the negative delta G in that reaction to produce glucose 6 phosphate is minus 16.7 kilojoules per mole. Compare this value with this value. Thermodynamically, how favorable it has become for a cell to carry out phosphorolysis. So these are the points that you need to remember about phosphorolysis reaction. Very good. So we have just seen that how glycogen phosphorylase in a single step, it will act on the non-reducing end of glycogen and removes that as a glucose 1 phosphate unit. And the glycogen will be glycogen N minus 1. So that is what we have seen. We have been saying that glycogen is a polymer, that is with an alpha helical structure. So it is a polymer with alpha 1,4 and alpha 1,6 linkages. So now let us see how the entire molecule is degraded. So therefore, let us come back here. So let us come to each one of these is a glucose residues. A is a glucose residue linked by alpha 1,4, alpha 1,4 linkage to C, alpha 1,4 linkage to D, alpha 1,4 linkage to E. But here you will see a branch point, that is alpha 1,6, alpha 1,6. So KLM, each one is a glucose residue. So this is part of the structure of glycogen. So glycogen phosphorylase will remove each residue. So Q is removed, no problem. P is removed, no problem. Okay, O is removed. Now when it has to remove N, that is remember 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 residues. So therefore, when it is 4 residues away from the branch point, glycogen phosphorylase cannot act. Okay, glycogen phosphorylase cannot act. There's a problem. So let us also deal with this one. So therefore, here is a branch point. This can be removed. Removed. 2. This can be removed. 1, 2, 3, 4. So up to here. So it cannot be removed because there is a branch point here. So our center focus is going to be this branch point. That is how we are going to explain breakdown. So now what happens when glycogen phosphorylase, maybe the active site is too deep inside. So it cannot reach this particular linkage to remove this glycosidic linkage by the addition of inorganic phosphate. At that point, we need an additional enzyme. We need a transferase enzyme. Okay, we need a transferase enzyme. What is the role of the transferase? Transferase will remove these three residues from here. Okay, so to break this, it will break an alpha 1,4 linkage is broken. Remember the energy level I had given. So an alpha 1,4 is broken and it will establish an alpha 1,4 here. So therefore, this transferase enzyme will transfer this whole unit here. Understood? So therefore, this becomes L, M and N. So this becomes a linear chain, rubbing this. This becomes a linear chain and that way it will expose only one glucose residue with an alpha 1,6 linkage. So therefore, we can rewrite it. It is A, B, C, D, E, F, G. This is L is added, M is added, N is added, and you have your, with the help of transferase enzyme, D is having the K here. Okay, that is after the activity of transferase enzyme exposing the alpha 1,4 1,6 linkage. Now the next enzyme we need to debranch it. So we have a debranching enzyme, that is alpha 1,6 glucosidase. It's interesting, this glucosidase and the transferase. Okay, so the glucosidase and transferase is part of a same enzyme. It's about 160 kilo Dalton. So two activities it is carrying out. Transferring by breaking an alpha 1,4 linkage, attaching by joining, making an alpha 1,4 linkage, and glucosidase. Now this enzyme, what is this glucosidase going to do? Glucosidase enzyme will act on this alpha 1,6 linkage and it will remove one glucose. So therefore, it is a hydrolytic reaction. So glucosidase is a hydrolytic reaction. It will add a molecule of water and glucose unit is removed. Understood? So therefore, We need the activity of transferase and glucosidase in order to remove the branch point. So once the branch point is removed, now our glycogen phosphorylase can act on this, can remove this, remove, till it encounters another branch, four residues away from a branch, it will stop. So through this process, and by using transferase and glucosidase, the glycogen molecule can be broken down. Two points that we need to remember here, is we have produced a glucose through the hydrolytic reaction. Now to retain this glucose, we need to spend an ATP, then only it becomes glucose 6-phosphate. See the energy expenditure here, if you look at the previous frame, the energy expenditure here is greater, minus 16.7 kilojoules per mole, in comparison to a phosphorolysis. Okay? In comparison to a phosphorolysis. Another important aspect that we need to keep in mind is, see, the we have seen that only 7% is with alpha 1,6, 93% is alpha 1,4. So therefore only 7% will be converted to glucose. Only 7% will be converted to glucose. That is another aspect that you need to see. And the final aspect is, we spoke about a molecule which is highly branched. Okay, and we spoke about the alpha rosette structure. Alpha rosette structure, remember that. So therefore, glucose will be removed like this and it keeps on becoming smaller. Branching is removed, it keeps on becoming smaller. That is glycogenolysis. When we need energy, when liver has to maintain blood glucose level, it will keep on decreasing it, degrading. And when we are synthesizing, it will keep on adding, and in order to make the molecule larger. So therefore, glycogen molecule will keep changing from smaller to larger and vice versa. So this is a constant process that happens in liver and in muscle. So this is to give you an overall understanding of glycogenolysis. So what we have seen, we have looked at the structure, and how the understanding the structure is very important to understand the breaking down of glycogen. And how in the two different processes, one is by using glycogen phosphorylase enzyme, how each unit is removed, and how we change in the branch point by using two other enzymes. One is a transferase, another one is an alpha 1,6 glucosidase. I'm sure this was a very stimulating experience for all of us in understanding how glycogen is broken down to its monomeric unit in order to either to maintain blood glucose level or to give energy. We will come up with more videos in future to have a greater understanding of carbohydrate metabolism.